it was the birth of my kids that pushed me from writing about gallbladders and New Guinea birds to writing books for the broad public to arouse interest and understanding of science and to get people to understand the dilemmas facing the world of my children.
And I encourage you afterwards to have Professor Diamond sign your book, because then you'll get a good look at his tie, which you can't see from there, but it is from, can you tell us where your tie comes from? It's awesome.
It's the tie of the British Ornithologists Union, to which I gave a speech on eating of dirt by birds. And in return, they gave me their tie, which depicts the sacred ibis. But please note that I'm color-coded according to the specifications of my wife. Red tie, red jacket, dark trousers, black shoes.
But those shoes did not apparently start out black when you left the house.
That's correct. I attempted to leave the house with brown shoes, and I got called on it.
And before we go to the heart of our talk, like, just when you're saying that, why do British ornithologists need a union?
For the same reason that all ornithologists need national unions. There's the American Ornithologists Union. I'm sure there's a union for bridge players and chess players, so why should there not be a union for ornithologists in each country?
Good question, and you have the tie to prove it. Thank you. All right, well, first question, just to set the table for this book. Like, you're Jared Diamond, the rock star that we know, who you're known for writing big books, dance books, sweeping books, epic books, long books, especially when they're translated into German. Am I correct?
One of the things, Sandra, that I discovered as my books got translated into foreign languages is that different languages say the same thing at different lengths. I just returned from Italy, where I discovered that my Italian translations are 10% longer than my English translation, English editions, but the German translations are 30% longer. And so in my recent book, which in English is 500 pages, The World Until Yesterday, was translated into German. My best friends in Germany told me, Jared, your next book, please make it shorter, because your book is too heavy to read lying back in bed.
That you lifting it up and down would be good. All right, but then people may not know, since you're, and these are thought of as adult books, and that you write for adult readers, but actually people may not know the reason that you actually began writing books originally. You take us back to, you're studying the gallbladder, right, way back when, and what happens to cause you to write books?
Well, I got my PhD for studies of sodium transport in the gallbladder, and I was professor of physiology at UCLA Medical School to teach medical students about the gallbladder and other organs, but I found the gallbladder confining, so I also had a career studying birds. And then in 1987, my wife's and my twin sons were born. Until then, I heard people talk about the things that will happen to the world in 2050, end of the rainforest, global warming, but whenever people talked about 2050 or 2070, I was born in 1937, so those are fictitious years to me. 2050 means nothing more than 2362. But when my kids were born in 1987, I realized with a jolt, my kids will be 63 years old in 2050. They'll be at the prime of their lives. 2050 is not an imaginary year. It's a real year, and so it was the birth of my kids that pushed me from writing about gallbladders and New Guinea birds to writing books for the broad public to arouse interest and understanding of science and to get people to understand the dilemmas facing the world of my children.
Right, but also I remember you have an anecdote about going and speaking at your son's school. Isn't that correct? When they're the horrible age of 10 and talking to their middle school the first time.
That's right. All of you who have been parents of 10-year-olds or teenagers know the unbridled admiration that teenagers have for their parents. And so my twin sons, when they were in, I believe, seventh grade, one day they came home angry at me. And I wasn't aware of having done anything exceptionally bad that day. So I asked them, what's the matter? And they said, Daddy, your book has been assigned to our class, And we haven't read it yet, but we know it's a bad book. And worse yet, our teacher has invited you to come into our class and talk about your book to our classmates, and we are so embarrassed. Well, so I came in, my sons were sitting in the next to the back row, averted, red with embarrassment, scrunched up in pain, and I began talking about my book to their classmates. The classmates were relaxed and interested and began to get lively and ask questions. My sons saw that my book was not loathsome and destroying their prestige in the eyes of their classmates, but that their classmates positively liked my book. So by the end of the class, my sons were facing forwards, they were in relaxed posture, and from then on, whenever they hear about a negative review of my book, they're indignant.
Oh, good. Yeah. As well they should be, but there aren't going to be any of this book. All right, and before we get a little bit into the heart of this book, is we should mention that the first version of this, the adult version we would call it, was published in 1991, and this is a new version. It's a beautiful book. You should see it. It's illustrated, and it's just, you can lift it easily without actually crushing your arms, and it's illustrated. But we could say that there's a couple of things that were left out in this edition.
Sandra.
Should I not have asked that? I'm sorry, I'm bound by will, just so that people know that they're two different books.
So you'll know what you're missing in the children's version. The adult version was 19 chapters. The children's version is 16 chapters, and missing, are a couple of chapters on one of the triumphs of modern biology, a theory of human penis size that was considered not suitable for children.
Kids watching
it's
this
an
webcast.
Evolutionary perspective.
Your ears. Yes, no. And can you dispense with that? Because everybody will be wondering all night long of what this amazing discovery was.
We have a good understanding of testa size. Testa size among primates increases with the number of males with which a female mates within a given menstrual cycle. So chimpanzees have a multi-male system. Chimpanzees have large testes because the male that injects the most sperm is most likely to fertilize. Humans are nominally monogamous, and they're often monogamous, so human testes are smaller, and gorilla testes, because a gorilla lives in a harem and there's no other male gorilla there. Gorillas have really small testes. But penis, the human, the chimpanzee has the largest penis, and the human male penis is several times larger than the penis of the gorilla. And we do not, Sandra, have an adequate theoretical understanding of that finding. That was considered unsuitable for children.
But you have a speculation.
My speculation is that, as with chimpanzees, the human male penis is not just a piece of functional anatomy, but that it is a display organ, because humans also have multiple males within a given society. Unlike gorillas do not need to display because there's only one gorilla in the harem. But that's my theory, and I've not been able to devise an experimental test.
All right. There are so many that one can't do. That's true. And yes, and then chimpanzees also can copulate quite quickly compared to us as well.
Well, the numbers, the scientists have studied this, as you can imagine, and the duration of copulation for chimpanzees is about 40 seconds. For humans, despite all the fantasies of American men, it's only 4 minutes. But for orangutans, it's 12 minutes, and better yet, orangutans do it hanging upside down in trees. That certainly tops human perform. Again, that's not in the children's edition.
Yes, not in the children's, so you can be relieved. All right. And I think one more question before we go and actually discuss the book is, do we still need to talk about evolution today and still teach it today, do you think? Which this book is for middle schoolers.
Do we still need to talk about evolution? Evolution is the foundation of biology, just as atoms and subatomic particles are the foundation of physics, and just as the understanding that the Earth is round and goes around the sun are the foundations of astronomy. If you don't understand those basic facts, you can't deal with the physical world, you can't deal with the astronomical world, and you can't deal with the biological world if you don't accept the fact of evolution. In addition, anyone who goes into the hospital and wants to linger in the hospital should know about evolution because of the recent evolution of antibiotic-resistant microbes. So if you are among the something like 70% of Americans, and incredibly the 60% of American university biology graduates who do not believe in evolution,
really?
Then you deserve to go into the hospital and come back with antibiotics.
I'm sorry, that's an extraordinary percentage.
Incredible.
That's an extraordinary percentage. Okay, so let us go into, I guess let's start with the book and the third chimpanzee. And I'll give you the sentence that opens it, and then you can elaborate how you will. The creation story of our time is the tale of three chimps.
The three chimps are, one of them, Sandra, is you and me, the human chimpanzee. The second chimp is the familiar common chimpanzee. And the third chimp is the bonobo or pygmy chimpanzee. It's been known and accepted for a long time that there were two species of so-called chimps in Africa, the common chimpanzee and the pygmy chimpanzee. But genetic studies of the 1990s revealed a bombshell, which is that the DNA, the genetic material of humans, is 98% identical to the DNA of chimpanzees, which means that humans are genetically as similar to chimpanzees as red-eyed vireos are to white-eyed vireos. And that also
which
means...
Which is a kind of bird.
Well, those are two kinds of birds.
Right.
Red-eyed
just
vireos.
For those who don't know what a vireo is.
Everybody.
Yeah.
So in 2% of our DNA, the 2% difference between us and chimpanzees lies the explanation for the fact that you and I are now sitting here talking language while chimpanzees are in zoos rather than vice versa.
Which is quite amazing. And I think also we're 1% Neanderthal DNA also, is that correct?
It's even more than that. Studies since I published the adult version of Third Chimpanzee, we now have sequencing of Neanderthal genetic material, DNA, and it turns out that all humans outside Africa have something like 2 to 3% of Neanderthal DNA, which is because as humans spread out of Africa, they encountered Neanderthals in the initial stages hybridized. We acquired 2 or 3% of Neanderthal DNA, but that was not the case with Africans who were in Africa. And so an active area of research now is, what is that 2 or 3% of our DNA that is Neanderthal? Recent studies suggest that it includes DNA that provides either susceptibility or resistance to diseases, but it probably also includes DNA coding for skin color, pale or dark skin color, eye color, adaptation to cold climates.
Well, I think, and to go back to us versus the chimps question, maybe it's just to set the table for our audience for a moment, is what are our similarities and differences from us and chimps? And you can enumerate. I think that we have language and art and religion are some things that humans have uniquely that you can talk about. But there's some, I found there were some wonderful moments in the book about what chimps do, particularly the one that paints. Do you remember?
Yes, indeed. There were some captive chimpanzees that were offered paints, oil paints, and some of the individuals were not interested, and some were interested. One captive chimpanzee was particularly interested and made lots of paintings, turned them out rather quickly. And the paintings were multicolor, they were rather imaginative. There were so many of them, and they were so interesting and thoroughly in the tradition of the modern art that a London gallery decided to put on a one chimp show. And all these paintings by the chimp were there. They were available for sale. They all sold, which is better than most human art.
Really good.
Artists do.
Really good.
But the painter was identified by name, something like Joe, but not by species. And in came modern artists. One of them, Wilhelm de Kooning, a famous artist, who said, these paintings capture the spirit of emotion that defines art. And there was a psychiatrist who came in and said, this artist is obviously a man, a male. Well, the psychiatrist had the gender right, but the species wrong. And when Kunning was told, these paintings are by a chimpanzee, he said, well, that's a damn talented chimpanzee.
Well, but I think also what I was struck in this story about little Congo, the chimp, is that he's in captivity, and it's like he painted all day. He just painted and painted and painted, and when they took the brushes away, he would scream. So he was driven to make art, would you say, or can all chimps make art?
The observation is that all chimps, when offered paintbrushes, do not make art, just as when humans are offered paintbrushes, I don't make art. Instead, I turn on the latest Bach cantata. There are other people who are into visual arts, and evidently with chimpanzees also, there are individual differences in chimps.
Well, but there is another animal who also does make art that is a very interesting example.
Bowerbirds. New Guinea bowerbirds, males to woo females, build and decorate complex structures called bowers. These are towers up to 8 feet high or huts up to 8 feet across. And they're decorated with natural objects, butterfly wings, fruits, flowers, beetle carapaces. Individual different bowerbird species and populations decorate with different colors or with different styles. On my most recent trip to New Guinea in March, I restudied a bowerbird, the Fogelkop gardener bowerbird, whose populations on the bird's head of New Guinea are well known to decorate with colors, many colors, blue, red, orange, and so on, purple. In the mountains that I was working on in March, they don't use colors. They use black, white, and gray. I had previously studied these bowerbirds on a slope 10 miles away, but the mountain where I studied the bowerbird in March, just 10 miles away from where I'd studied them before, they've got a new style. Their decorations include a long rectangular pavement up to about 8 feet long and a foot in diameter, made up of small rectangles, brick-like rectangles that were brown. And we finally figured out that these rectangles were clay, but they were placed there very neatly, rather like this platform, neatly laid out there. And evidently, in that area, females prefer males that have good rectangular pavements.
And mow the lawn, I suppose, also. I think it also, in this interspecies sort of understanding, I think you've also said that You have a long history of bird watching, and you began at 7 bird watching, and it's birds, much of the time, relating to other things. You've said that what you have learned watching birds has illuminated something about human beings. Also, the gallbladder has, but
yeah. My background as a scientist came from two directions. I did my thesis on sodium transport in the gallbladder, and so I was hired by UCLA Medical School to teach gallbladders to medical students. But also, having been a bird watcher at age 7, I developed a second career studying birds, and then eventually I got interested in questions of human societies. Well, with humans, one cannot do experiments in which you manipulate humans. If, for example, you wondered what is the genetic basis of resistance to AIDS, and one had no moral scruples, you could divide this room and everybody on this side, we inject with saline control, and we come back in 30 years, and we can unequivocally settle what's the basis of genetic resistance to AIDS, but that's immoral, illegal, and impractical. Similarly with birds, with gallbladders, one can do experiments with impunity. One compares a gallbladder in potassium to a gallbladder without potassium. When I started to study New Guinea birds, I'm not permitted to go around exterminating New Guinea bird species or transplanting them. I had to figure out other ways of making comparisons. And the way that one learns about birds in captivity is by observation, by comparing different mountains on which a given bird species is present or absent, and you can then see what the presence of that bird, what effect it has on other bird species. Similarly, when studying human populations, if one wants to understand why, for example, Europeans expanded around the world rather than Aboriginal Australians, you can't do the experiment of transplanting Aboriginal Australians to Europe 10,000 years ago. You got to do the natural experiment. You have to compare populations and figure out. So it was initially from gallbladders, learning the techniques of experiment, and then from birds, learning the method of comparisons, that I also learned how to study human populations, which is make comparisons, don't study human populations one by one.
Interesting, okay. So the second, we were talking about the three things that make us human. One was art that we discussed, another was language. Can you talk about the how humans might have evolved language and your take on that?
Language, so language is distinctively human. There are, of course, other animals that have vocal communication, notably birds. What's distinctive about human language is grammar, namely that we can combine words in an indefinite number of sentences. So the sentence that I just uttered, I've never uttered in my life, but all the words in it I've uttered thousands of times. So humans, through language with grammar, have devised far more expressive capacity, far more information communicating capacity than any other species. The great, but humans diverged from chimpanzees only 6 million years ago, and chimps don't have language, which means that human language must have evolved within the last 6 million years. When did it evolve? What were the original uses of language, and what made possible the evolution of language? That's one of the big questions with which I wrestled in The Third Chimpanzee.
And you suggested one very interesting answer. Care to share that as to why it evolved?
My speculation, and it's only a speculation, is that chimpanzees that have been brought up as infants in the home of human psychologists.
Which is an interesting practice right there.
Made grunts similar to human babies, but from about age 1.5 onwards, the human babies had far more refined capacity for speech. Chimpanzees can only pronounce a couple of consonants and one or two vowels, and that seems to be the result of the anatomy of the chimpanzee voice box, which is like a Swiss watch. The human voice box is like a Swiss watch. So my speculation, Sandra, would be that the magic breakthrough that allowed us to develop language, which was then a prerequisite for all sorts of good and bad things, was a change in the anatomy of all those fine pieces of bone and muscle in the human voice box within the last 100,000 years that resulted in our capacity for language with grammar. But once you've got language with grammar, you can then talk, discuss, brainstorm, and out of that, within the last 70,000 years, comes for the first time art and rapid invention, which there was not before 70,000 years ago.
And one of the book is really fascinating, and one of the many fascinating comparisons you do is how a pidgin language, which is very basic, becomes a Creole language. And I guess I'm going to ask the audience here at the 92nd Street Y, how many of you would love to hear Professor Diamond speak to us in pidgin? You can buy a plot. Okay, you have to really want it. Okay, you ready?
Here's an example of pidgin. Dispella Sandra. Emi number one pella meri, e good pella to mus. Grass belongum e black pella, e no yero pella. Na I belongum e dark pella through. Sandra e tall pella, e no licklick to mus. Tas whole tintin belong Sandra, e good pella more yet. Sandra, you win em through.
Thank you. Whatever, I I love the last slide. And said in your tie is really quite a moment. Okay, and then of many other things that are so interesting in this book is one on the phenomenon, the distinctly human phenomenon of menopause. Apparently, yes, we have it and other animals don't. And it's sort of a puzzle as to why, I guess, females just don't wrap out babies all their lives and then drop over dead like many other animal species do. But you've also said it's something that makes us uniquely human.
Menopause is a real puzzle because naively an evolutionary biologist would say that evolution is about producing more offspring, and therefore you would think that the last thing that any species would evolve is a mechanism to shut down the reproductive tract. And yet in humans, in females, the reproductive tract is basically shut down in the 40s in all women. What benefits does that bring? And if menopause is good for women, then why have men not evolved menopause? Menopause is really exceptional in the among mammals, among something like 4,000 species of mammals. The only one, other ones that I know with menopause beyond humans are killer whales, short-finned pilot whales, which have female menopause, and there's a marsupial mouse, a little kangaroo relative in southeastern Australia, where males undergo menopause but not females. So if menopause is good for something, why is it good for women but not for men, and why is it good for male marsupial mice but not male humans? Naturally, I have a theory about this.
Will you be kind enough to tell us your theory?
My guess is that it has to do with, every woman here who's given birth knows that the human baby is large compared to the mother, much larger than a gorilla baby with respect to the mother. And so childbirth traditionally was really dangerous for women. And of course, as women get older, the chances of bringing it off successfully under traditional conditions decrease. So you have a woman in her 40s. If we think of this in evolutionary terms, if a 50-year-old woman becomes pregnant, the chances of bringing off the pregnancy successfully are decreasing with age, and the chances of her dying in childbirth are increasing with age, but she has her prior children still dependent on her. So basically, a mother who gives birth at age 50 is gambling the lives of her prior offspring in the hope of having one more baby. Whereas with, so women can die in childbirth. Men never die in childbirth. And that, in short, is why
unless they're filming and standing too close.
That's why women. That's, I think, why women evolved menopause and men didn't. That leaves the question why male marsupial mice undergo menopause. Male marsupial, they're short-lived. They get only one chance to mate. They live only for one season. And in that one season, you're not likely to live to a second season, so you might as well knock yourself out impregnating as many females as possible, even at the cost of not eating. And so you shut down your reproductive tract, you put all your energy into running around chasing females, and then you die. That's the strategy of a male marsupial mouse.
Well, that's even sadder than our fate.
The point that I want to make is that a male marsupial mouse that has mated in 1 year is not going to get a chance to mate in the next year, and so menopause is okay. Whereas a human male who's mated in 1 year probably has a chance of mating the next year, and therefore menopause is a big mistake.
It is, in any case, for women, as I can tell you, being 52 and in the middle of it, hot flashing. There are really so many interesting things in this book. One thing I thought I would ask you about is this peculiar discovery about couples, about how human beings are attracted to other human beings. It's really a very surprising discovery, I think.
This is something that psychologists, of course, have studied. I mean, all of us have had the experience that when we walk into a room, when we're unmarried or available or single, when we walk into a room and scrutinize the people in the room, it's not that you have a checklist and go over the checklist and figure out who's the person most attractive to you. Very quickly, within a few seconds, you figure out who's attractive to you. So each of us carries in our mind some blueprint of who's attractive, but it's clear that some people like blondes and some people like dark, et cetera. One of my sons likes tall women, another of my sons like short women. So where do these preferences come from? What psychologists have found is that people tend to mate with partners who are similar to them in as many traits as possible. But that's to say, tall men on the average marry tall women. But we consist of many independent characteristics, so we can't get a good match in all traits. And I experienced that when I was dating my wife Marie, because Marie is a wonderful marriage, 35 years, but early in dating Marie, and I described this in Third Chimpanzee, I realized there's something about Marie that just didn't suit me, but I couldn't figure out what it was until Marie and I, about a month after we began dating, went to the ballet, and I had opera glasses. I looked with the opera glasses, and I handed them to Marie, and then she handed them back to me. And Marie had scrunched up the opera glasses, and I had to open them up because Marie has much more closely set eyes than I do. So Marie and I are well matched in most characteristics except for interocular distance. And the reality is that throughout my life, I've always preferred women with wide set eyes. Well, I found my peace with Marie's close set eyes because of her other virtues. But that illustrated to me that my eyes are relatively wide set. So we try to find a mate who matches us unconsciously in as many characteristics as possible.
Yeah, I think it's finger size and also even lung. There's a lung measure.
The best predictor, listen to this, all of you who are on the market now, the best predictor of compatibility and a happy marriage is equality of length of third finger.
Which is very telling. Yeah, everybody who's on the market with us tonight and Friday night at the 92nd Street Y, that's for the dating that will come later. I think moving forward, there is one other characteristic that we have that's maybe not a great human characteristic, and a tendency to destroy the environment. And I think that you can illustrate that by kind of suggesting to people what they would see if they stepped right out of the 92nd Street Y 13,000 years ago. All right.
If we had a time machine and we were all here, but you stepped outside the door 13,000 years ago, what you would have seen out there would have been like the Serengeti Plains of Africa. You would have seen lions, cheetahs, elephants, equids, that's to say zebras and horses. You would have also seen things for which there's no parallel today, like giant ground sloths. That's to say, North America was, and South America and Australia were full of big mammals in the past, just as Africa still is today. But around the time that humans arrived in North and South America, about 85 and 90% of the big mammal species of North America died out. Well, murderers have been convicted on the grounds of less decisive correlative evidence. It seems likely, a theory which seems likely to me, is that the big mammals of North America went extinct because humans arrived, humans were skilled hunters, the mammals had never seen humans before, and so the first humans in North America could walk up to an elephant and spear the elephant, and the elephant didn't know what was coming to it.
And I think that sort of is an interesting take and spin on some scientists or theorists who have this idea of that the earlier people were beautiful, elfin, peaceful, nice people that came before. But in fact, we've seen people ruining their environments in many cases, Easter Island being one and others, that has existed prior to now.
Yeah, it's not that people who ruin their environments are evil people. I mean, we ruin much of the North American, much of the world environment, and it's not because we're evil. It's partly because of ignorance, partly because, say, managing fisheries or managing forests is difficult, and it's also because of conflict of interest, that there are people who profit by overfishing, by being the people who will catch the lobsters and catch the cod. The reasoning is that somebody's going to catch that cod. It's going to go extinct anyway, so I might as well be the person to catch the cod. So conflicts of interest are one of the factors that have driven human overexploitation of the environment.
And I think then that leads to another question, of which there's a couple takes to it, is that, you know, for most hunter-gatherers, actually, that's the longest-lasting and most successful way of living of our species. If you look at agrarian society, I mean, you say that in a 24-hour day, that's the whole history of the human race. Only like the last 4 minutes has agriculture started. So, and then it's led to sort of states that are built, to leading to the 1940s, when we can start to blow ourselves up now. And let's say in the future, and let's say we do blow ourselves up and destabilize our world, and then let's say we have to go back to living as hunter-gatherers. Do you see that as a possible scenario?
Yes, it's definitely a possible scenario. So the numbers are that humans diverged from chimpanzees 6 million years ago, and we were hunter-gatherers for the entirety of the 6 million years until agriculture began about 11,000 years ago, so 11,000 divided by 6 million, your math is faster than mine, but so we've been hunter-gatherers for all but the last 2 minutes of the 24-hour clock. Considering what might happen to the world in the next 50 years, suppose either there is nuclear war, or suppose something gentler happens, namely that we overexploit and destroy the environment, and we are driven back to a hunter-gatherer lifestyle because we can't sustain a first-world economy. Who's going to be best off 50 years from now? And it's clear that the people best off will be New Guineans because they were making stone tools and doing a lot of hunting and gathering until relatively recently, whereas probably no one in this room knows how to make a stone tool. So in the worst case scenario of a nuclear holocaust, if there are people who survive, it will be hunter-gatherers.
But we could wiki how to make a stone tool on our phones, right?
Sure. But the technology for Wikipedia will be gone. But
No, entirely not possible. I can't believe that. I think then that brings us to another thing that you've said, and if you could elaborate a little bit further. You say, and this is so true, the societies whose cultural practices now dominate the globe owe that domination to their economic and military success. These qualities aren't necessarily the ones that encourage happiness or promote long-term human survival. But you also say that, you know, and that some of our tendencies to prolong our own species are not necessarily good things. They can be like adultery or kind of, you know, stealing other people's brides, etc. But that sometimes we can make an ethical choice not to do that. And I wonder, and some of these ethical choices now may in some way starting to help. I mean, the fact that the IPCC just met and all these nations came together to discuss climate change, I mean, surely that's that's a first ever event. Is there some way that our ethical behavior is an evolutionary step forward?
That's a really interesting question. Regardless of the answer to the question, it's also one of the grounds for hope. There are plenty of reasons to be pessimistic about the state of the world, but one of the grounds for hope is that humans, unlike any other animal species, do have ethical concerns, and those ethical concerns may cause us to act in ways that do not serve passing on our genes, so that there are plenty of people who decide not to have children as a matter of choice. There are most human societies today do not go out and try to conquer or exterminate neighboring human societies, although they would pass on the genes of their own society more effectively if they did so. So particularly within the last couple of centuries, we've developed what I would call a universal code of ethics. If you read the Old Testament,
right,
it's pretty nasty. In the Old Testament, people were encouraged to go out and exterminate the people next door. And that was a widespread pattern in human history until it's only within the last several centuries that the Ten Commandments have been generalized to all humans. That's to say, not only are you not supposed to kill the members of your own in-group, but by all means go out and kill the people next door. But now ethical standards mean that you're not supposed to kill anybody around the world. And that's drastically new. That's only within the last few centuries that universal ethical code has become widespread.
Right, and I think there's an interesting point you make about global cultural diversity, that on the one hand, when these older society tribes come into first contact with modernization, they lose their they lose the specific languages that they had, and you say like the number of languages has really shrunk right now in terms of what you can trace today. But at the same point, you say that perhaps there's something that comes out of lack of cultural diversity that is good. That if you don't see that other person as the other anymore, then perhaps that's hopeful. I mean, that's maybe one of the few things that can come out of this as good.
Yes, it is hopeful not to regard the people next door as vile enemies who should be exterminated. The reality is that, for example, in New Guinea and in North America, when Europeans arrived, had something like 300 Native American languages. At the rate we're going now, there will be two left at the end of this century. There are only two Native American languages that have radio broadcasts. And you can bet that if a language doesn't have radio broadcasts, it's not going to be around for much. Navajo and Yupik Eskimo have radio broadcasts. In New Guinea, of the world's 9,000 languages, 1,000 are confined to the island of New Guinea. And the typical New Guinea language, the median New Guinea language, has 2,000 speakers. There are lots of New Guinea languages that have 60 to 200 speakers. These are not dialects, these are full-fledged languages. I remember on one occasion in New Guinea meeting a missionary couple, Americans, so with whom I could identify, studying one tribe in New Guinea, they were missionaries, to translate the Bible into that language. And I asked them, so why are you devoting your lives and bringing your children out to New Guinea in order to learn this one New Guinea language and translate the Bible? Their answer was, it's such an important language. In this area of New Guinea, it's the largest language. It has 600 speakers.
Oh, God. that's extraordinary. Let's see, we're going to go to some questions now for a bit, but I think also you can see how like young people need to actually read this book and learn this for our future. Okay, so how about this? Must evolution conflict with religion, do you think?
Must evolution conflict with religion? That is debated. There are many scientists who are religious. There are also atheists, some of whom are scientists and some of whom are not scientists, who have no use for religion. There's a whole foundation that works on reconciling science with religion. That's a long-winded way of saying that the question is open whether science and religion are mutually compatible.
So, right. I like this question. It's something that we were talking about a little bit earlier. What is the role of the public intellectual in today's society?
What's the role of the public intellectual, and specifically, how about the public scientist?
The public scientist, exactly, and I think you were talking about Carl Sagan earlier today, which is kind of interesting, but what do you think, the public scientist?
So what's the role of the public scientist? The American economic advantage today depends especially on American technology, which is based in science. Science is the basis of power, and to get jobs in the modern world, to get good jobs, you have to understand how the modern world operates, but that is what science is about. But the public will understand science only if scientists explain science to the public. Unfortunately, most scientists do not explain science to the public. Until age 55, I was talking about sodium transport in the gallbladder, and I was not seeking to communicate the excitement of the gallbladder to the public, which would be a losing proposition. Anyway, there were rather few scientists who attempted to explain science to the public, and yet it's vitally important. And the tragedy is that those scientists who do try to explain science to the public, like Carl Sagan, often get flack from other scientists out of jealousy, trespassing territory, the sense that if they're explaining science to the public, it's because their creativity is all washed up.
So, I think it's good for scientists to bridge that gap now.
It's essential to
bridge. Yeah, I mean, especially because, yes, 4 out of 10 Americans still believe in creationism, so it's a huge number.
You're underestimating, I think.
Yeah, I think. All right, well, here's an interesting question. With the rapid advances in technology, does the study of geography matter as much?
Oh, God. Does the study of geography matter?
Uh-huh.
Geography was one of the standard disciplines in the United States, along with history and mathematics and so on. And geography started to crash in the 1950s. Geography departments got closed down to the point where today, there are, I believe, only something like 76 American universities have geography departments, because the sense in the United States was that geography is a matter of memorizing the names of state capitals. And the reality is that the United States felt that it was protected by oceans, so we didn't need to know about those other countries out there. But since September 11, 2001, the United States is no longer protected by oceans, and it has become really important for Americans to understand where Afghanistan is and why Afghanistan is the way that it is and where Somalia is and why Somalis hijack ships and where Bolivia is. That's to say, geography is essential for understanding the modern world. We are penalizing ourselves, just as we are penalizing ourselves by not understanding evolution, not understanding atoms. We're penalizing ourselves by not understanding geography, but horrifyingly, the National Geographic Society every 10 years polls Americans and 10 other countries on their knowledge of geography. And would you imagine that the majority of Americans cannot locate New York City on the map? Cannot locate Afghanistan on the map. But worst of all, the biggest feature on the globe is the Pacific Ocean. If you close your eyes and point, you're more likely to hit the Pacific Ocean than anywhere else. And more than 50% of Americans cannot locate the Pacific Ocean.
Oh my God.
That's our knowledge of geography.
Oh my gosh, okay, that's terrifying. So good question. And we will try to get to almost all of them, but we may not have time, but let's go for this one. This is apropos of tonight's the book. What story would you tell someone, perhaps a child, story would you tell them to begin teaching them about evolution for the first time?
Wow.
You have to compete with the Adam and Eve story, I guess.
How do you tell children about evolution for the first time?
And it says, what story? And you are the story.
What story? A possibility would be to show them fossils, to show them dinosaurs, to ask them what happened to the dinosaurs. They were big, powerful, dominated the world. Dinosaurs did not evolve into humans, but a branch of dinosaurs evolved into birds. But Sandra, that is such a challenging question, I haven't thought about it. Rather than stumble around, let me think about that, and the next time you and I talk,
Daniel McNichol. Thanks a lot, Daniel, for that question.
That's really a very good question.
Yeah, good. Okay. You stumped Jared Diamond for the moment. This theme seems to be coming up quite a bit, and you talked about it a little bit, but why not give it a... Here's another one you'll love from our audience. What is the next stage of human evolution?
What is the next stage of human evolution? It's very simple. The next stage of human evolution is to see whether we can get through the next 40 years. If we can get through the next 40 years, then it means that we will have solved basic problems of the world, such as resource exploitation and inequality between nations, and we will then sail on into a bright future. Whereas if we do not solve those problems within the next 40 years, we are finished. So I would say that's the main question of human evolution now.
Why the number 40? What's magic about four decades that you picked that?
Four, three, five decades. At the rate that we're exploiting world resources at the moment, at the rate at which we're exploiting fisheries and forests and unutilized water supplies, for most of these resources, we have between 3 and 5 or 6 decades before we get beyond the point of no return. And that's why I say we have to get onto a sustainable course within the next several decades. But of course, if we wait until 49 years from now, it'll be too late. We need to be getting onto a sustainable course now.
And you've also talked about like how archaeologists can help. You've said paying archaeologists to determine how much firewood the Anasazi consumed would be cheaper than making the same mistake and ruining 100,000 acres of woodland as we may now be doing. So can archaeologists, like an Indiana Jones, save the day?
Archaeologists can contribute to saving the day. That's to say, archaeologists study what happened to past societies. And among past societies, some solved their problems and some failed to solve their problems. The Anasazi, working in a really difficult environment in the U.S. Southwest, did not solve the problems of drought in the U.S. Southwest. Rather than running the experiment 10 times today and failing 9 times, an alternative is to look at how past human societies dealt with problems and see which societies, like the New Guinea Highlanders solved their problem of sustainable forestry. The Easter Islanders did not. We can learn by looking what happened on Easter Island, looking what happened in the New Guinea Highlands, rather than destroying our forests and messing up ourselves today.
Beautiful. Speaking of Easter Island, I have an Easter Island question right here. Although before we go, doesn't Iceland pay its archaeologists?
Iceland pays.
They don't need a union there, or they have a union.
When an archaeologist friend of mine came to the Icelandic government and requested support to study overgrazing by sheep in the past, and he thought that he was going to have to do a hard sell. He talked for a minute or two, and the Icelandic minister said, you don't have to tell me anymore. Here's the money. Go study it. Because in Iceland, the Icelanders realized that in the past, Iceland had big problems with overgrazing by sheep. But Icelanders in the 1200s, 1300s solved those problems. And Iceland today also has lots of sheep and problems with overgrazing. The Icelandic government has realized that you can learn by seeing where Icelanders made mistakes and where they solved problems in the past. Iceland, the archaeologists can show us the results of the experiment that's already been run.
Right, so they don't have to run another. All right, so here's back to the Easter Island question. The reason for the collapse of Easter Island is similar to the predicted collapse of mankind due to climate change. Yes, our small brains can't delay gratification. Theirs in cutting down forests, ours for making excess profits burning fossil fuels. What's your best hope to avoid extinction of humans on Earth? And what do you think about that analysis of Easter Island? And it's a 12-part question.
Okay, yeah. The two pieces, Easter Island, that Polynesian island off the coast of Chile, deforested itself completely, but this was a wood-dependent society, so that was bad for the society. And in Easter Island, it appears that there was competition between neighboring groups to erect bigger and bigger statues, which required timber to drag the statues, and timber for fertilizer. So the Easter Islanders did not develop a sustainable economy. And now I've got so wrapped up in the question that, Sandra, I've forgotten the other half of the question.
I did too. I'm mesmerized in what you're saying. Thank God I have a card. Okay. Oh, it's what's your best, it's a similar theme again. What's your best hope to avoid extinction of humans on Earth?
What's my best hope to avoid extinctions of humans on Earth? It is children and young people who are the ones who are going to be affected by the consequences of what we older people are doing today. My hope is that children will make wiser decisions than their parents are making in their own self-interest. And the fact is that children tend to be more environmentally concerned today than are their parents. If children can make environmentally sensible decisions, and if children can prod and shame their parents into making good decisions, then we have a better hope of solving our problems within the next 30 or 40 years.
Yes, but I guess the question that comes to mind is which children, given now we live in the wild, weird West, weird, which you've said stands for Western, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic. Weird. We're weird. Okay. And our children are weird. So there, you know, it's been said that, you know, America is 20%. I mean, we're only 4% of the world and we use 20% of their resources. You sort of make the argument in the book that, you know, we say, well, the agriculture has worked out pretty well. Look at us. But you say it's because other countries have much poorer people who are laboring to keep our country going. So, I mean, do you think it's important to educate our children here in America as to what's going on in the rest of the world, which is quite different?
It's especially important to educate children in the first world because the first world consumes much more. There are many, many Americans. I had one colleague at UCLA who said, I'm really worried about population growth in Africa. Rwandans have families of eight children. Kenyans have large families. That's a big problem for the world. And yes, it's a problem for Kenya and Rwanda, but consumption rates per person, consumption of fossil fuels and water and metals, is on the average 32 times higher in the first world, the United States, Europe, and Australia, than in the developing world, which means that each American is the consumption equivalent of 32 Kenyans. That's why I'm not really worried about those Kenyans. It's a tragedy for Kenya, but it's not a tragedy for the world. Instead, I'm worried about the consumption rates of us Americans and Europeans and Japanese and Australians.
Right. Right, and I think that's a good reason for them to make all YA versions of all your books so that these kids can read about what's going on everywhere in the world.
What a wise lady.
Yes, from my mouth, okay. Will you humor another menopause question?
Sure.
Why not? It seems of the hour, the moment. Might the fact That's, you know, this is great. It's kind of debate with Professor Diamond evening. Might the fact that human eggs deteriorate also contribute to the development of menopause? Similar to your marsupial mouse, it puts pressure to have children earlier on in the female's lifespan. Eggs.
Interesting idea. Is a factor behind menopause that eggs deteriorate? Everything in our bodies deteriorates. Our eyes, our ears, our hair deteriorates. Deterioration is a matter of biological repair. It's subject to evolutionary control, evolutionary investment. We humans invest enough in our teeth that our teeth are still functioning into our 70s, 80s, and 90s. Men invest enough in their sperm that their sperm are still functioning into their 70s, 80s, and 90s. Why don't women invest enough in their eggs that their eggs are also still working well into their 50s and 60s? In short, the answer to that question is that deterioration is something that's subject to evolutionary control through evolutionary cost-benefit trade-offs.
Okay, can you say that in a slightly simpler way?
Sure.
Because I am menopausal, so I might start to kind of float in the middle of something really smart like that.
We humans evolved to invest in keeping our eyes working into age 70, 80, and 90. We did not evolve to keeping our eggs working to age 70, 80, or 90. There are evolutionary reasons for that, and the evolutionary reasons that I speculate were the ones that we went through.
Right, and actually reminds me of what I said was one of my favorite sentences from the book that is so funny, and it is great, and that is human infants, you said, are terrible food gatherers. Isn't that a great, I mean, that's putting it lightly, I would say, but are terrible food gatherers, so we have to work longer to keep them going.
To set that in perspective, baby young chimpanzees, once they're 4 years old, young chimpanzees forage for themselves. But humans, once they're 4 years old, they're helpless. They don't forage for themselves. Even in traditional societies, children are still getting much or most of their food from their parents until early teenage years. So yes, human infants are relatively helpless, and that may be part of the reason for the human distinctive family structure,
right,
namely that men hang around.
Exactly, and now would the kids live with us until they're 30, so it's really gonna change.
27.
I knew we'd get it out of you eventually. If you don't mind humoring one more debate Professor Diamond question this evening. Well, it's not really a debate, okay. Beyond food availability, can you explain cultural differences in chimp and bonobo populations based on geographical elements and other variables besides resources?
Really interesting question. So the two species of chimpanzees are the so-called common chimp, which is widespread, and the bonobo, the pygmy chimp, which is confined to an area of Zaire. And the bonobo is quite distinctive, differs from the common chimp. Common chimp meat hunts. Bonobos have not been observed to meat hunt. Bonobos have lots of rampant sex, more than common chimps do. In bonobos, females are dominant. That's not the case in common chimps. So what is it about, but obviously, common chimps, 2.5 years ago, what is it about the ancestral chimpanzee population of Zaire, the Congo, that caused them to evolve in the direction of bonobos? An interesting speculation is that chimpanzees coexist with gorillas in most of their range of Africa, except in Zaire, where the bonobo is. And so the suggestion is that maybe in the absence of gorillas, the chimpanzee population in Zaire had food opportunities taken over by gorillas elsewhere, evolved into a gorilla-like niche. It's an interesting speculation. That's the best I can do.
That is very interesting. Okay, here's a, what is the evolutionary possibility for extraterrestrial life?
What is the evolutionary possibility for extraterrestrial life? If you look out at the sky, not in New York City, but in Montana, and look at all those galaxies, or if you read the newspapers, there are now something like 1,000, several thousand planets discovered out there, or maybe hundreds of planets that seem to have conditions suitable for life, water, moderate temperature, etc. Surely with those trillions of galaxies and planets out there, there must be billions of planets with life, and surely millions of planets with intelligent life. If so, where are those green extraterrestrials? Why we have we not been visited? One possibility is look at what's happening on Earth now. Once you get creatures who are intelligent, they can use their intelligence to advance their interests and destroy their interests. So a possibility is that we've not been visited because every intelligent society destroys itself before it can send out the rockets that reach Earth. And there are astronomers today who not only are searching for extraterrestrial life, that's fine, innocent, harmless, but there are astronomers who have beamed out messages to outer space to encourage them to come and sit down and have friendly conversations with us, in the naive assumption that they will, that when the green extraterrestrial is viable, they'll have friendly conversations with us, believing that when they find intelligent creatures like us, they'll sit down and have a conversation. Well, what did we do when we discovered the next most intelligent creature on Earth, the chimpanzee? Namely, we chopped off its hands, we put chimpanzees in zoos, we injected them for medical experiments. I consider that the most dangerous people on Earth today are astronomers who are beaming messages to outer space.
That's good. Or you said, like, when the Cro-Magnons met the Neanderthals, except for a little bit of mating, they didn't respond.
It was not sit down and let's discuss the essence of Neanderthalism.
Yes. And I think a question that I have is, like, what do you currently, I know your next book, can you speak for a moment about your next book that you're working on?
My next book will be on national crises. Nations have crises. It looks to me like the U.S. is heading into a crisis now. There are nations that came through crises. Some solved their crises. Some were less successful at solving their crises. And so the book that I'm just starting to work on now will be to look at national crises and what we can learn from them. What are the factors that make it more or less likely that a nation will solve its crisis? So it's a comparative study, like comparing gallbladders and comparing birds and comparing human populations.
But I'm curious, when you're in the middle of writing a book like this, have you mapped it out and do you know the ending? Or is it a process of discovery as you're ruminating and thinking about this that you suddenly find other studies? Do you yourself learn as you write these books?
Yes. Yeah. The answer to your two questions, Sandra, is yes to both. Yes, I've mapped out the book. I have an outline of the chapters. This Tuesday, so 3 days ago, I began teaching a new course at UCLA, which is on the material of the book. And basically, I'm trying out the planned next book on my UCLA students to see what they like and what they don't like and what they understand and what they don't understand. The last chapter I envision will be on world crisis. And what are the lessons? I can see some of the lessons now, but as with my previous books, as with Third Chimpanzee, I will learn in writing the book. I will learn from my UCLA student. For example, when I was teaching my UCLA students the material in my book Collapse, one of my students asked me the question, what do you think the Easter Islander who chopped down the last tree on Easter Island said as he was chopping down the last tree?
Oh.
And I had never thought of that question. Well, I'm sure that my UCLA students will wake me up to questions this year and next year.
And if there is, speaking of the young people and spreading the word, there's another public intellectual question, which is regarding social media. And I'm going to ask the question, then I make a comment that I think is funny. Do you engage the public via social media, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook? Why or why not? I know that famously you do not use a computer. And you write on yellow legal pads, and if I may, and I know I'm going to get killed for telling this story, apparently you went to Google today to speak, and you said, what is Google?
Well, I knew that Google was a big business, but I did not know what Google produces or what Google does.
No one does, actually.
I do not use computers. I do have a cell phone. It's the first cell phone that I bought 15 years ago. It does not record messages, or I haven't figured out how to record messages with it. I always keep it turned off, except when my wife orders me to turn it on. I can use this cell phone. I cannot turn on my computer when my wife and sons have tried to teach me how to turn on a computer, and they say, it's simple, look, it doesn't work. And they say, whoops, this went wrong, but it usually works, but it never works when they don't.
Well, so that answers that person about social media. And I guess you do, and as you're right, I'm going back to your book for a minute. How many years does it take you, like this Nation's book, how many years will that take you? I'm just curious, and what, how many hours a week do you write on that? How do you work that out when you're not doing social media, which you should?
Which is never, yeah. All my books, with one exception, have taken between 4 and 7 years. As for the amount of time a week that I put in, it depends upon what else is going on that week. Some weeks I can put all my time into my books. Sometimes there'll be a couple of weeks where I can't put anything into my books. The one book that took much less time was my book on sex. It took me only 6 weeks. It's only 167 pages. And you can speculate on the reasons why the book on sex took less time.
Yeah, I think the book is Why is Sex Fun?
Question mark.
And I can ask you the question, Professor Diamond, why is sex fun?
After 167 pages, I concluded that I didn't know the answer.
Yeah, that's good. And one more question, because I know there's been a lot of questions about the next stage of evolution or humanity, survival, et cetera. I think that I'm curious, perhaps in your career, now that you're at the peak of your life, as you like to say, in your mid-70s, you used to think that, you know, 20-year-olds were old and then 30s and then 40s, but that you actually felt like life only really, I think you said, got good at 60. You said, if you recall, that at 60, suddenly things became easier, better, and that you figured in your 70s right now, you're peaking, and that you may not really be old until you're 90. So you've had, and I trust you still feel that way. You said that shortly and then went, climbed a mountain or something like right after that. In your pretty long career, and that you're able to now revisit books like The Third Chimpanzee, 1991, right after the Cold War, but you already anticipated that environmental ruin was going to be a really big problem. That was before climate change came on. In your long career, what would you say maybe at this moment was just the most surprising thing you ever came upon that you went, I did not see that coming?
Wow. The most surprising thing, I did not see that coming. Well, naturally, having children. So. I see babies. I knew about babies. I knew about children. But you got to have them there and you got to hold them to know what the experience of bringing up your own children is.
And that really surprised you?
Yeah. One thing that surprised me, I like to work. And I sit at my desk working, and one day when one of my sons, Joshua, was 5 years old, he liked to play, so he came in, and he wanted to start playing with me. And there I was sitting at my desk and working, and I thought, I want to get on with my work. And then I realized, look, Jared, for heaven's sakes, get your priorities straight. Here's this adorable boy who wants to play with you and is willing to spend time with you. And in 10 years, who knows whether he'll want to spend time with you. Take advantage of it and put your work aside. I did not anticipate that before I had children.
I think that may be a good place to end. I think that was the most surprising thing. It can't get better than that. All right, well, it is 9:15 now. I think that's a really surprising place. I did not anticipate that you would say that. I thought it was gonna be about the bonobo or the woodpecker, so I was surprised. So thank you. Do go and get your book signed. Again, you can see the tie close up. It's an ibis, you have to see, it's really amazing. And thank you for being here, and thank you, Professor.
Thank you, sir.